Review. We're kind of studying the highlights of the history of Western philosophy. Kind of like when you watch the evening news and they have a 30-second segment about a game, like a football game or a basketball game, right? The game was 3 hours, but they show you just the most extraordinary plays and they tell you the score. That's kind of like how we're treating the history of philosophy. It's about 2.5 millennia, 2,500 years, and volumes and volumes and volumes of ideas that could fill an entire library, and we're just taking some little teeny tiny bits of it as we move through. But this is a sort of timeline that gives you a sense of our syllabus for the semester. We spent all of our time in the ancient world, particularly the ancient Greek and the Mediterranean world, in the ancient time period. We're gonna look at the Roman world now, but again, we're still in the ancient period. Then we'll stop very briefly in the Middle Ages. Then we'll move on to the modern period where you are going to explore modern philosophies that you are interested in and research those, present to the class, and hopefully we'll have time to have maybe one or two seminars on modern philosophers. So just be aware of this as a timeline. On the final written exam, I'll put questions about it. And the philosophers we've looked at so far are all part of the ancient world, kind of foundational. So, we're going to look today at Epicureanism and Stoicism. Those are two very different philosophical schools or philosophies. And here is where you're going to have to make a definite choice because you cannot have it both ways. You're either an Epicurean or you're a Stoic, or neither, but you can't be both. So my goal is that by the end of class, you'll kind of have a sense for which philosophy you sort of lean towards. And actually, before we begin, I wanted to give you a little survey. Just take out a sheet of paper. Normally it comes out, but I wanted to change it. I haven't done that yet. So this is a little survey, just to kind of help you sort of figure out which philosophy you might lean towards a little bit more.
Can I do it in the...
Yeah, absolutely. This is just for you. You won't have to hand it in. Let me turn this off. Okay. So maybe put Stoic at the top of your paper on one side and Epicurean on the other. Let's try this. So I'm going to ask a series of questions, 8 questions. Huh, this would have been fun as a Kahoot. I should have thought of that. And there are going to be 2 answers for each question, a Stoic answer and a more Epicurean answer. So just put these 2 words at the top of your paper, and I'll tell you which is which, but sort of pick the answer that you would lean more towards. So listen carefully. Does everybody have a pencil or something like that? Stoic, Epicurean, and Stoic. So here's question 1. You think that either there's a God who pretty much runs the universe, or there is no God, or maybe there is a God, but he is not high on my list of things to worry about. So the first answer is a Stoic answer. You think that there is a God who pretty much runs the universe, or you think that there is no God, or maybe there's a God, but he's not high on my list of things to worry about. That's a more Epicurean type of attitude. Question 2. You would rather be either focused and self-disciplined or easygoing and careful. So if you're a Stoic, you want to be focused and self-disciplined. And if you're more of an Epicurean, you want to be more easygoing and careful. Okay. You got that one. No in between. Get out of both ways. So question 3. If you had to choose, you would rather live Epicurean with a few close friends or Stoic alone. If you had to choose, you would rather live Epicurean with a few close friends Stoic alone.
Is this all in one house?
Yeah.
So I gotta
be rubbing elbows with those people.
Also, I gotta be the same. I thought it was just.
Go with your gut instinct. Your gut instinct.
Okay, 10-year home.
Okay.
No,
wrong question.
What is happiness? Happiness is pleasure, enjoying the good things of life without going overboard. It's Epicurean. For the Stoics, happiness is more a sense of finding your purpose in life and doing your duty. Finding your purpose in life and doing your duty. So for Epicureans, happiness is pleasure, enjoying the good things of life, but without going overboard. Happiness is
hard. Choose one or the other.
Hang on, Jeffrey.
Thank you.
I love this class. Okay. Okay, question 5. This is more metaphysical, like what you think is really real. The human person is either,
the Stoic answer would be, a physical body with a spiritual soul. The human person is a physical body and a spiritual soul. Epicureans. The human person is a physical being. We have bodies and our minds are part of our bodies. So the Epicureans would say we're purely physical beings. Whereas the Stoics would say there's a soul that's separate from the body. It's not inhabits the body.
When you die, you die. That's the end. That's the Epicurean.
Stoic. We know the body decomposes. The soul, perhaps it goes back out into the universe or into God. We don't know for sure, but there's some kind of afterlife, some kind of ongoing existence for the soul.
No.
Two more. 7. How do you handle it when people upset you?
Oh.
I communicate with the person right away and try to solve the problem.
No.
I step back and remind myself that I cannot control that person's behavior.
Neither.
How do you identify
with
either
option?
One of those?
Yeah.
That's an option?
What's your gut instinct?
Argue back.
Can you repeat them?
Okay. How do you handle it when people upset you? I communicate with that person right away and try to solve the problem. I step back and simply remind myself that I cannot control that person's behavior.
What happens if you're like a mix of all of these things?
You have a problem. You've got to sort yourself out by the end of the semester.
I am clearly one of.
This is great, I love it. Okay.
Thanks, patient.
Last question, here we go. You think that, and again, this is metaphysical, everything happens for a reason. Stoic. Or, shit just happens. Epicurean.
Sometimes shit just does happen.
Okay. Do we have anyone who knows they're an Epicurean here? Good. It's always fun to have real Epicureans in the room. Do we have anyone who is an absolutely hard-ass Stoic here? Knows they're a Stoic. We got at least one, maybe two. Three. Okay, good.
What was number one again?
Number one, you think that, like this, again, this is sort of a metaphysical question. The Stoics think there's a God who pretty much runs the universe. It's kind of hand-in-hand with there's a reason for everything. And then the Epicureans think there is no God. Maybe there is, but I don't really care. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And it's a shit just happens kind of attitude. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Things just happen. Any questions? What is happiness? Number four is what is happiness? So, pleasure. A lot of people think that they are Epicureans with this question because it's very appealing. Live in the moment. YOLO. Do you guys still talk about that? Right? But it's not really. We have to be careful here. The Epicureans, a true Epicurean views happiness simply as pleasure. I want to enjoy this moment, but doing it in such a way as not to cause pain later, which means not overindulging, and we'll talk about that. So, but really, for an Epicurean, happiness is just pleasure. It does not go beyond that. Whereas for a Stoic, happiness comes from finding your sense of purpose. It's also, a Stoic also wants to be free from strong emotions. So a Stoic is absolutely not pleasure-seeking. Stoics have the ability to bear tremendous amounts of pain. So that's kind of the impression people have of Stoics.
What question was it?
That was question four. I think Amber also asked about five.
Yeah.
A human person is a physical body with a spiritual soul, or a physical being only. We have bodies and our minds are part of our body. So let me talk a little bit more detail about the background or history of these two points of view. And hopefully by the end of it, we'll have a sense of where you're at and which seminar reading you want to do. We'll talk about Epicurus first. Now, both of these schools, Epicureanism and Stoicism, originated in ancient Greece, but flourished in the Roman world. So we get a little taste of Roman culture and civilization, which personally I love. I mean, spent 4 years studying classical Latin. So first we'll talk about Epicurus. His family was from Athens, but he moved from place to place. His mother made a living. We're talking about the oracle at Delphi and the whole concept of spirit possession and those forms of religion. Supposedly, according to the histories I've read, his mother made a living as a kind of shaman or witch doctor. And he may have reacted to that in terms of having a very negative attitude towards superstitious forms of religion. So he rejected what he would regard as superstitious forms of religion. And he studied the philosophy of our good friend, Democritus. Jeff's nodding. According to Democritus, what is the basic principle of all things? Remember our good friend, the Mediterranean philosopher Democritus, end of the packet? Atoms, yeah. So it's basically a sort of scientific materialism. Everything is just atoms and matter and energy. That's all. All that everything is. But what Epicurus did that Democritus didn't quite finish doing was Epicurus spun out the ethical and metaphysical implications of that view. If you're really serious that everything is just atoms, here's what you've got to accept for ethics, for metaphysics, for the afterlife, etc. So that's really what Epicurean philosophy is based on. I like to think of this as a kind of a Jimmy Buffett philosophy. Don't worry, be happy. Sitting on the beach drinking a margarita. Right? That's what, I don't know. You guys ever listen to Jimmy Buffett? I'm from Cincinnati, I do. Used to.
You're from Cincinnati.
Yeah. So in a sense, this is a hardcore scientific materialistic philosophy. So Democritus' metaphysics, the conviction that everything is just made of atoms, underpins or supports his ethics, which is the pleasure philosophy. So the body and soul are made up of atoms which disperse when we die. So the soul itself is made up of teeny tiny little particles. And when you're alive, those particles are spread throughout your body. But when you die and you breathe out your last breath, they just dissipate like vapor or smoke and it's gone. So he thought that the soul was real, but he thought that it's just something physical. So there is no afterlife. There are gods, and some of us were talking during the midterm exams about the gods that the ancient Greeks believed in. They were polytheistic, right? Zeus, Apollo, Hermes, all of those figures. So Epicurus thought, sure, there are gods, but they do not interfere with human life. So we don't need to sacrifice to them to make sure that good things will happen to us. We are responsible for what happens to us. Remember Democritus? People ask in their prayers for help from the gods, but do not realize that the power to attain this lies within themselves. Same kind of idea. Don't pray for stuff, work for it. The ethical goal of Epicureanism could be described as this kind of a virtue. Autarxia literally means unstirred upness, calm, tranquility, easygoing, peaceful cheerfulness. So when I think of something being stirred up, I think of a pop can and what happens when you shake it. The goal for an Epicurean is just not to be that way. Just to be able to be laid back, unstirred up. Epicurus established a commune, a kind of like a life with a few close friends, in a place outside of Athens that came to be called a garden. Kind of like a hippie colony. A few people living together, living a simple lifestyle. He focused on pleasure, but through moderation. So life, the happy life for an Epicurean is simply a string of pleasurable moments. And you want to move from one pleasurable moment to the next. But you realize that if you overindulge in pleasures or fail to work for what you need, you're going to cause yourself pain later. So you don't do that. You enjoy pleasures, but in moderation. You work for what you need, but you make sure that your needs are few and your wants are simple. So leading a simple lifestyle is actually part of this. You don't need a million-dollar mansion in the suburbs, because then you'll have a $1,000 monthly mortgage payment, and you'll have to work 3 jobs to keep up with it. What is the point? Be happy with a simple house in Hammond. Pay it off in 7 years and be debt free. You will be a much happier person. Or do you really need that Jaguar or that new Jeep or the latest cell phone? Because again, you strap yourself into having to work too much to pay for those things. So embracing a very simple lifestyle is actually part of Epicureanism. So if your wants are few, you'll be happier, faster.
So basically we should settle for just being simple.
Yeah, it's a great way to put it. I realize the word settle has a negative connotation, but the Epicureans would say, yeah. If you can persuade yourself to be happy with a few simple things, you're going to have much more pleasure in your life than if you want something really extravagant and you're unhappy because you can't get it, or you get it and it causes you pain later. So being happy with a few simple things would be an Epicurean approach. Jesse?
So my question is about the source of the pleasure. Is it just materialism? Or
yes, it's absolutely material. And one can be emotional, too. You enjoy a few close friends. But an Epicurean also would not want to fall in love. And if you do the Epicurean reading, you're going to read that he understands that. Why? Asher, can you explain?
Because love is a dangerous thing.
Yes, that is absolutely what the Epicureans would say. And the Lucretius reading, if you read the Epicurean reading, you're going to read a Roman poet's advice on how not to fall in love. Because falling head over heels in love, you get this emotional attachment to the person, you spend all your money on the person, and you don't want to do that. So an Epicurean would be happy, excuse my language, with an F-buddy. Right? Enjoy the pleasure, but don't have the emotional attachment or entanglement. Yeah, you'll read that if you read the reading. The Roman poet Lucretius writes about that in kind of humorous
ways. I'm still going to read this one.
Wait, so they want you to have an F buddy all your life?
Wait, what was the last of that?
They want you to have an F buddy like for your whole life?
You would not want to get entangled in a permanent relationship. Unless...
But,
that person could share with you that very sort of simple lifestyle. If the person were more like a friend, is willing to share a simple lifestyle.
And the Epicureans tracked.
Did they what?
Did they attract?
Yeah, but I think in a pleasure way, not a virtue way. Yeah, that's a good question.
This
like what?
I was like, so are they good friends?
Yeah, I think this is a really different philosophy from Aristotle. It's really different. So Epicurus left us very few writings. The one that I know of is called The Letter to Diognetus. And if you do the Epicurean reading, the first 10 pages or so are just very short sayings but they're challenging to read. They seem easy on the surface, but you really have to think about them. And then there was the Roman poet Lucretius, who wrote a book called On the Nature of Things, where he took Epicurus' ideas and spun them out into a whole philosophy. I've given you just a few pages from a part of the book on sensation and sex. It's really about love and sexuality. But it's challenging to read because it's poetry. So it's just a few pages, but it's pretty dense. Okay, so that's Epicureanism. Now let's shift gears to something completely different, okay? We're shifting gears into Stoicism now. Stoicism also flourished in the Roman world. And in some ways, both of these philosophies match the Roman mentality. The Romans were famous for their orgies, right? Their crazy parties, so they may have taken Epicureanism and then kind of gone overboard with it. But they were also famous for a very Stoic mentality. And I've chosen this image of an aqueduct. This is it's a channel that brings water from the mountains in Spain into a city, miles and miles of it, and it still works 2,000 years later. I mean, look at the cities we live in now. How often are they ripping up the streets to fix the water infrastructure, like every 10 or 20 years? 2,000 years. So the Romans knew how to build stuff. They were very practical people. They did three things exceptionally well: build, govern, and what they were probably most famous for, wage war. The Romans stumbled into an empire without meaning to. This is what one of my professors in Chicago once said. They were just defending the city of Rome, but their armies were so powerful and so efficient that every time they beat back the invaders, they gain a little bit more territory, and then they do it again, until the thing expanded into an empire that stretched from Britain in the north to east, the Near East, really in the east, and then to North Africa. And they really held the empire together through a system of laws and government and roads and transportation and defense, a powerful and effective military. I read a long time ago, I don't know whether it's true because I can't find the source anymore, that Epictetus, one of the original Stoic writers, he was a slave who earned his freedom, that one of his books was like a training manual for the Roman army. So this is a very disciplined, hardcore, almost harsh philosophy, suitable for soldiers who had to march 100 miles in a single day and be ready to fight at the end of it. So Epictetus, just be aware that he was one of the original Stoic philosophers and he was a slave. The person whose writings will read, if you read Stoicism, is at the other end of the social scale. So Stoic philosophy represented that type of practical, stern discipline. Ethics, again, was its main focus. How should we live in order to be happy? Same thing as the Epicureans, but the answers were very different. And the ethics is undergirded by a metaphysics. So the Epicurean metaphysics, everything is atoms. And if you believe that, here's how to be happy. The Stoic metaphysics is very different, so we have to talk about it. So here are some Stoic principles, important Stoic principles. The universe is governed. I'll go back to that one. The universe is governed by logos or reason. So that concept of everything happens for a reason or a purpose is a very Stoic idea. Not an Epicurean idea, for Epicureans, shit just happens and it's random. Everything's random, pretty much. Or maybe it's governed by physical laws, but there's no overarching purpose to things. As individuals, we are a small part of something bigger and more important. So the focus is never on me and what I want. The focus is on what are my responsibilities, what are my duties as a citizen, as a human being to the rest of the world. So I like to go back to this image. Each of us is like a stone in the aqueduct, and we have our place. And we'll be happy if we can figure out what our place in the universe is and really fulfill that role. That's where happiness comes from. So it's not individualistic. And there's a very strong sense of duty, honor, and a work ethic. I like to compare it with rowing in an eight-man shell, where you have to blend into that crew and be part of that crew. It's not about you. You follow stroke, and you become a part of something bigger than yourself, and you forget about yourself and what you want, and you have to tolerate massive amounts of pain as well. So another Stoic principle is to distinguish what is in your power from what is not. So for example, when someone is upsetting you, your first response is to realize that's just an impression. I'm hearing this person talk, I'm seeing their face, those are just sense impressions, and I can step back from that and realize I do not have any control over that. So when something's bothering me, I realize that it's bothering me, but I also realize that is not within my power. So I let go of it, of that. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me. That is a hard teaching, and Stoicism, friends at home, this is not something to talk about outside of this classroom, has actually helped me in my marriage. Because there have been times my spouse has said or done things that I have felt very hurtful, that I've had to step back and tell myself, he's being who he is. I don't have to let that affect me. I don't ever want anyone to think, however, that that is a reason to stay in an abusive relationship. Definitely don't want to take it in that direction. But I have to tell you, Stoicism and building a Stoic attitude has helped me in my marriage. So, and here again, the soul is a totally separate center of consciousness and freedom. It is not part of the body. And ultimately, you are always free, and you always have a choice. So Stoicism is a no-excuses philosophy. There is never any excuse. You are always responsible for your decisions. And that's debatable, because we can talk about the influences of society. We can talk about the influences of someone's family on that person growing up. We can talk about the influences of addictions. All of those things would tend to mitigate against this idea. But a Stoic would be adamant. At the end of the day, the buck stops with you and your personal decisions, and it is never an excuse. The Stoic goal is apatheia, non-suffering, not to be affected by strong emotions. So Stoics don't want to feel extreme pleasure, and they don't want to feel extreme sadness. They don't want to be either joyful or sad. They want to always walk this middle path of not being affected by emotions. In a way, it's kind of a harsh way to live. Epicurean would be like, why? Why don't you want to have pleasure in your life? So it's a very different way of thinking. I kind of like to compare this to rowing in a single, which is a very, very small boat. When you're out on the water in one of those things, you realize that you're surrounded by these enormous forces that you do not control. You don't control what the water's doing, what the waves are doing, what the wind is doing. All you control is what is in that boat. But once you realize that, you can go fast. When you control what you're doing with your hands and your body, you're in control of that little boat and you can really do something. So life is kind of like that. I don't control what's going on around me, but I control what's in here, what I decided, what I do. So our Stoic author is Marcus Aurelius Antoninus, or just Marcus Aurelius for short, or just Marcus for short. He was a Roman emperor. He was the nephew of the emperor Antoninus Pius. And in the first chapter of the book, which I didn't put in the reading, but I'll give you if you want it, he praises all of the people who've been good influences in his life, including his uncle. His uncle adopted him in order to make him his successor. So there was this period of about three Roman emperors, which historians sometimes look back on as the golden age of the Roman Empire, a time of relative peace, relative prosperity, and wise government for Rome. Marcus Aurelius was the last of those. Has anybody here seen Gladiator? Watch that movie. That's Stoicism incarnate. Marcus Aurelius is the old guy at the beginning, but the main character, what's his name? No, Commodus is the bad dude, Marcus Aurelius' son. The main character of the movie really embodies Stoic ideals, in a sense, I think. Okay, so he was well educated, valued the influences of people in his life, and he studied the philosophy of Epictetus. He became emperor in 161 and reigned for about 20 years, till about, I think, about 180 or 181. He died while out on a military campaign. A Roman emperor was essentially a general, so he was out in the field with his armies in Europe, spent much of his time in Europe. And so while he was out on those military campaigns with the armies, he'd write in a journal, a little book that came to be known as the Meditations. So that's what you'll be reading if you choose to read Stoicism. Marcus Aurelius' Meditations. And he's honored as one of Rome's wisest rulers.
You have the answer to it. You have the answer for the question?
Which one?
The main, Maximus.
Maximus, thank you. I should have remembered that. Yeah, so this is the main character. This is the portrayal of Marcus Aurelius. As if, here he's an old man. When I think of him, I picture this character though. So what I need now is to know who wants to do what readings. How many of each reading I need to go photocopy?
Are we having a seminar?
We will have seminars when you get back.